Today we reach the last unit in first year criminal law. The concept of duress is an affirmative defense. Like all the other affirmative defenses, except for self-defense and defense of others, this is a situation where the defendant has the burden of proof by preponderance of evidence to show that they were acting under duress as legally defined in the jurisdiction in order to be found not guilty. There's only one case in this unit, although I'll connect some of the pieces from our prior subsections of affirmative defenses to make it a little easier to apply the test. And in fact, we read a duress case at the very beginning of this chapter, Dixon, for the Supreme Court talking about the burden of proof. So I didn't feel there is much need here to have a series of cases because, like necessity and justification, you know, our very first general affirmative defense, this is an extremely hard defense to win. And I'll talk about why as we get through the test itself and the one case we have here. So let's look at the modern test. And for our purposes, we'll use the same under the common law and MPC. Like justification necessity, it can be framed and structured many different ways. I've taken some of the language from big cases in this area, the case we have, and also the excerpt from Robinson, because for each of our three subsections here, I use the Paul Robinson and others sort of encapsulation of the modern law here. But you'll notice even, for example, in our one case, they use the word immediate threat as opposed to imminent threat. So there's always different ways of framing it, but this is the essence of the modern test. And I've divided it into four prongs, but it can be restructured into one prong if you were going to read the Robinson quote that way or in different ways. But these are the critical ideas. Again, we see choice of evils. And in fact, choice of evils is more or less embedded in all our general affirmative defenses. It's just taken for granted in self-defense and defense of others that the person acting in self-defense is choosing their own life, which is in some way more innocent than the other person's because of the dynamic of the situation. And so, yeah, this is always sort of a baseline, but it needs to be explicitly handled in both justification necessity and in duress. So again, you cannot, if you're only under duress of being slapped across the face, you cannot commit a bank robbery. That would not meet the choice of evils prong. Second, imminent threat of unlawful, severe bodily injury or death. So this is very similar to justification necessity. We have this imminent and clear harm. Sometimes, you know, again, the language can be altered here. Severe bodily injury could be serious or could be grievous. Death, obviously, is what it is. Unlawful, meaning that you can't argue duress if the threat is from a lawful source, like a police officer or, say, a prosecutor, you know, who's leveraging a person to cooperate with the threat of prosecution or penalty because that's considered lawful threat of, say, the bodily injuries associated with incarceration or, say, the death penalty in some cases. Three is reasonable belief the threat will be carried out. Again, some jurisdictions use the phrase well-grounded fear, but we're going to stick to what seems to be the approach across the board, which is an objective test here, meaning would a reasonable person believe that this threat can be carried out? So if, you know, somebody you've known for many years, you have no reason to believe they're connected with organized crime or with terrorist organizations, and they tell you you need to go rob the corner store or they will blow up the nearest building with, you know, high-yield explosives and hundreds or thousands of people will be killed. It probably won't be reasonable for you to believe that threat will be carried out without extra information, right? If he actually shows you the explosive, shows you how he would do it or something along those lines, then it becomes a reasonable belief. So it can't just be any idle threat. You have to have reason to believe it will be carried out. And so certainly if, for example, somebody's threatening you with death and they're have a gun, well, that's pretty sufficient to establish a reasonable belief. And then the fourth prong here, which we might think of as is akin to or similar to the no legal alternative part of the test in justification necessity, the no reasonable opportunity to escape threatened bodily injury or death. And this is the point where our duress defenses just fail again quite widely. I mean, just across the board, it is a major issue. Because if somebody is not surveilled, not constantly put under, say, the threat of a gun, or say if the duress is placed on a third party, meaning say it's your spouse or loved one who's being threatened with violence, and you individually are being asked to commit the crimes, if they are not being surveilled and have an opportunity to escape. But it's important that escape doesn't just mean physical escape here. And especially in our modern era, this is where the real problem comes in. The opportunity to call 911 and report it to the authorities is, in many cases, just an absolute bar here. If you can call 911 and get help, even if you fear that that help will bungle the operation, or that your family members will be killed before the authorities will get there, that the burden is put on the defense to show that this was not a reasonable opportunity to escape the threatened bodily injury or death. And that can be quite difficult. So this is often the most difficult portion of the test to me. And in fact, it's one of the two prongs where we see the majority in dissent disagreeing in our specific case here. So similar to justification necessity, this defense is not available in homicide cases under the traditional common law approach. The model penal code drafters left it more open. So at least under an MPC jurisdiction following their duress defense, a defendant would be able to argue duress in a homicide prosecution. But again, they're going to have to meet all the parts, and choice of evils becomes especially difficult when the evil you're committing is homicide. This, of course, has been the plot of many movies and TV shows where people are asked to either kill others, sometimes commit violent crimes that risk death, like bank robbery and so forth. But the simple fact is, defendants are not afforded much latitude here. And you can think of reasons why not just this specific rule is in place, but also there's a reluctance to give duress defense. You might think that every member of an organized crime unit or a gang or whatever, you know, form of criminal conspiracy is constantly under duress. If you are not doing your job, your criminal job, if you were thought to be a rat and defecting or giving police information or speaking too loosely, most, you know, of these large scale organizations are going to kill you. That is a simple reality. And so it would be strange if people who voluntarily join, you know, these organized crime entities, committed crimes on their behalf, were able to argue, well, I was under duress the whole time. Because once I joined, then I was caught in this hard situation where I didn't have any great choices. And this is also where the last sentence of the excerpt from, oh, I guess it's the second to last sentence as opposed to the count of jurisdictions that have it, in the Robinson excerpt, which says the defense is not available if the actor culpably placed himself in a situation where duress was foreseeable. In other words, joining the gang precludes you from then arguing that the gang created the duress. And so even though that's not part of the four-part test, it's more of just a limitation in the same way we discussed limitations like initial aggressor and other concepts in our prior two general affirmative defenses. So this idea about why it shouldn't be allowed in homicide is also generally why the defense duress defense is defined so narrowly. But that will create some oddities, as I'll talk about after our case. So I'm not sure how to pronounce Nyoye. I can't quite get it right, so I apologize for my failure to pronounce it. This opinion is written by Judge Kavanaugh, who's now Justice Kavanaugh. I've been teaching it before he was appointed to the Supreme Court. But I do want to tell you some sort of unusual history to this case. In fact, I taught a prior version of this case that was before the D.C. Circuit. And this is one of the extremely rare instances where a panel decided the case one way. Then there was a motion to rehear it, and this was not an en banc review by the whole court, and there was no other action by the Supreme Court or anything else. There were some other things that changed, but for now, I'm just going to tell you the simple story. It switched. And so originally, Kavanaugh wrote the dissenting opinion when I started teaching this case, and Judge Sentell wrote the majority, but now it's reversed. And we can talk about why this occurs. But I think one of the reasons is this, like many of our other defenses, or all of them, is really just a matter of discretion. Judges can come out either way on these issues. There's not well-defined law or statutory structures that dictate, for example, whether or not battered person syndrome is relevant for duress, or how broadly or narrowly the no reasonable opportunity to escape prong should be interpreted. So why is the slide? I mean, I don't mean to make light of the situation here, but I think the critical fact here, and perhaps the reason that Kavanaugh is inclined to say that the defendant here, who I can call Queen because that's her first name, and it makes I then avoid butchering the last name some more. She is able. He thinks she should get this argument in large part because of this unique fact, right? There's a lot of defendants who participate in crime at the behest or pressure of another. In this case, somebody they were in a relationship with. And duress defense will be denied, right? Just merely being in a bad situation, between a rock and a hard place or any sort of pickle or whatever euphemism you want to use, is not going to be sufficient. But the argument that Queen has here that's unique is she has come from another country where the police are extremely corrupt. And the defendant has told her that he is not just a law enforcement officer. He says he used to be an FBI agent, and that if she goes to the authorities, they won't help her. And in fact, he will retaliate against her. So this really changes the analysis on a couple levels. And it's where these two prongs that differentiate Kavanaugh and Sentell emerge. And I think that's why I want to highlight it just in the picture, because I think this is the critical fact. For one, it means that we get a greater sense of why battered person syndrome here is relevant, right? The abuse she suffered at the hands of her, you know, our boyfriend and co-conspirator created a, you know, significant feeling of being controlled, traumatized, and abused, reminiscent of the type of environment we just looked at in our Michigan case in self-defense and defense of others. And it makes her more inclined to think she can't escape, and that therefore the threat she is experiencing is imminent, even though she is not directly under threat of a gun or a weapon at the time she facilitates this sort of extortion. That's, you know, that evidence of battered person syndrome goes right to imminence in the same way that it would in self-defense and defense of others. But it turns out this is, you know, a question that, you know, courts have dealt with, and a lot of them have come out the other way. So whereas, you know, the large majority of our jurisdictions have at least recognized on paper that battered person syndrome is relevant for defense of others or self-defense, less so in the case of duress. Many jurisdictions just said, no, you can use it for self-defense and defense of others, but it doesn't apply to relax the imminence requirement in duress. But it's still an open question. These are more recent cases. These don't come up much. So there's a lot of jurisdictions we just don't know what's going to happen in this area. But I think the choice of evils here is pretty much in her favor, right? The extortion versus the threat of death, you know, that at least gets to the jury and I think should work in her favor. And I can go back to the test here just so we can walk through it. The imminent threat, well, if you decide that this battered person syndrome evidence is admissible, I think she can meet it. But if not, right, it's Sentell would contend. And he also is objecting to the fact that she doesn't have the same type of evidentiary record that many people who want to offer this theory do. Then in fact, Sentell's dissent logically follows from that, right? In other words, if you're not going to allow this evidence, it's difficult for her to show an imminent threat at the time she's committing the crimes of extortion. The reasonable belief the threat will be carried out, even Sentell doesn't push back there, right? So based on her background and knowledge, right, which is not the same thing as a subjective belief. In other words, coming from where she did, where there's reasons to distrust authorities, knowing what she knows about her boyfriend, it's reasonable to believe the threat will be carried out. He's abused her and has shown a willingness to do this. Now, he might be adding lies to that, but it's entirely reasonable to believe the threat would be carried out. But then again, we see another divergence here. And I think this is the one where Sentell is may represent the majority of judges across the country. I'm guessing here, it's hard to say for certain, that a lot of judges will look at this and say, well, she had lots of opportunities to escape because she's not constantly under surveillance, and she has lots of opportunities to alert the authorities, calling 911 or whatever. But I think Kavanaugh handles this right, at least in deciding if it should go to the jury, because she has a very different type of story here. To her, 911 is not an escape. And the idea that she can run away is also not is viable, because she believes that her boyfriend, understandably so, has all the government resources to track her down. And so in that circumstance, it seems reasonable to go to the jury, right? To let them decide. But I said Sentell might represent the majority here, because judges are very disinclined to allow duress defenses to go to juries, just like justification and necessity. And I don't know if their fears are warranted, right, that basically this will become a loophole and lots of defendants will be able to exploit it and get not guilty verdicts. It's not clear that even in cases that go to the juries, defendants get a lot of not guilty verdicts out of these. The simple fact is, like justification and necessity, duress is an extremely narrow defense. And because the burden is on the defendant, it is extremely hard for them to win. And so, you know, thinking about this case in relation to our other defenses, right, she could have argued this is a straight justification necessity defense, although there she would have the extra legislative purpose prong to deal with. And that would be problematic. And so this is probably the better avenue for her. But strangely, and this is where I say some of the oddities that emerge from the defense-friendly nature of self-defense and defense of others, she is in a far better position if she kills her boyfriend, right? In other words, the law in this situation seems to be encouraging her to commit a homicide, right? And then excusing her for it. And this goes back to the discussion in Dixon between the majority and dissent at the beginning of this chapter. We might wonder if this is good design for our criminal law, where we're encouraging persons like this not to, you know, commit a lesser harm of extortion and, you know, then be excused. We're encouraging them to commit a greater harm, homicide, and then be excused. And this is where our law is. So, you know, whatever you think of that normatively, and if it's justified or sufficient, you know, in saying this is how it should be, it's just a simple fact that with the burden shift, the fact that self-defense just doesn't have as onerous of a test, and it excuses mistaken beliefs, either subjectively or objectively, self-defense and defense of others is a far better defense for defendants. And so defendants are, in effect, you know, if we believe deterrence theory or even just incentives that the law is giving, they're encouraged to engage in a form of self-help that's violent. They are, at minimum, supposed to use some force, if not lethal force, to escape these types of situations, as opposed to, you know, just committing crimes under duress. So I leave that note there, but do want to clean up a few other loose ends. There is a type of case that sometimes emerges here, a type of fact pattern, where defendants are in even worse situation in terms of getting legal recognition of the argument, which generally goes under this label brainwashing, however we want to refer to it. So one famous example of this is Patty Hearst, the heir to a major media empire, was kidnapped by a terrorist group, the SLA, and committed many bank robberies from them. Her abuse, you know, I think a lot of people aren't really aware of, at least if we believe all of her story. I mean, she was kept in a closet for a long time. She was sexually abused, physically abused, just really denied a lot of basic liberties in every way. And, you know, she developed, it seemed, what we call Stockholm Syndrome. She came to identify with her captors and participated in their crimes. This is a form, we might think, of brainwashing. And so this is one case that's talked about where, you know, the court was not inclined to give her this argument that she was acting under duress because she'd been brainwashed to believe that there was an imminent threat that she could never escape. You know, in fact, she was given a weapon, which I think really was seen by many to undermine this theory. But there's also cases going back to the Korean War from the U.S. perspective, where soldiers were kidnapped, tortured just brutally, physically, in varying ways for a long period of time. And then when their captors believed they had broken them and effectively brainwashed them, they were released back to the American armies, and they were spies for the enemy forces. And they were caught spying, and they wanted to argue that they were under duress because they believed, because of all this torture, that they were under an imminent threat and that they had no reasonable opportunity to escape. And they were denied this defense. In other words, that form of brainwashing has not been allowed to relax the imminence requirement or the no reasonable opportunity to escape requirement. Whereas, at least our case with Queen Nguyễn, it seems to indicate at least some jurisdictions say battered person syndrome is different, right? It's not the same as brainwashing. So if you can, you know, fit your argument into a battered person syndrome, which somebody who's tortured could, you can possibly get this argument before a jury if you have the majority view in the D.C. Circuit case. But if you have the minority or the dissenting view of Judge Sentell, you won't even get to present it in those circumstances. So I just want to distinguish a similar type fact factor, but a little different than the concept of battered person syndrome. And so that's it for duress, our last affirmative defense. And this concludes your lectures on first year criminal law.